Welcome back to The Great Debate, where this week we're asking, is Britain still great? Britain's built its good name around the world on parliamentary democracy, the rule of law and economic stability. We rightly make much of our soft power with our culture and our language, but last week's market mayhem seems to have rocked confidence in all of those attributes, and there are now serious questions over whether Britain remains a safe bet. Let's go to our viewers panel on this and talk to Paul Peachey. Paul, I think you're in Wales, is that right?
That's correct. Good evening to everyone.
Good evening, Paul. Your thoughts?
Well, my question, I've got a question for the panel. Is it time to rebuild our relationship with other countries in order to regain respect from the international community and build our standing as Great Britain again?
Thank you, Paul. So there's Paul's question. Is it time to rebuild Britain's international standing? And I want to talk to Simon now, before we come back to our panel. Simon, how do you react to Paul's question about our international standing?
Well, I query our international standing. I mean, my question is pretty straightforward, and I'd just like to know what we've done in the last 20 years that's made a difference.
You basically think that we haven't really... We've lost our prestige.
Yeah, we've lost our prestige. We've lost our influence in the world. I mean, you've only got to look at the treaty we signed in 97 with China, which guaranteed Hong Kong's independence as a democracy for 50 years. China's ripped it up. We did nothing that made a difference.
OK. Let me come to the panel. John Longworth, you spend a lot of time, I think, with businesses and trading across the world. Do you accept this picture of our diminished role in the world?
I think from a trade point of view, British goods and services are still highly respected and desired around the world. And the UK is making efforts to reach out to the world at large, to the Commonwealth and to the Trans-Pacific Partnership, to participate in those trade activities. But, you know, we should remember that Britain's strength and its future was and will be built on the domestic economy, which is 70% of GDP. And what we need is to have a vibrant, innovative domestic economy with high productivity and growth so that we are all prosperous. That's what will make Britain great from a business and economic point of view.
But we just heard from Simon that we may tell ourselves all of those things, but nobody believes it any longer.
Well, actually, I mean, I find that incredible, really. I mean, I've done business on every continent, and I have to say that a lot of other businesses abroad and government officials actually really look to the UK for things like product standards, for good quality product, and are still very keen to buy from the UK. But we have neglected that to some degree because we became very insular when we were within the European Union.
Deborah.
Well, I kind of agree with that, but I don't think we can measure a country's greatness just on business. You know, we do have a voice in the world. We always have had a voice in the world, but it is very much based on legacy. I totally agree with you. And what we haven't done is formulated what we want to be. Who do we want to be? I think we've lost our way. We've lost our character. And it can't just be focused on an economy. You know, we used to have a voice that was listened to. And I have to say, when I go about business, I hear a lot of people, and I do a lot of international trade, and I hear a lot of people saying, you're great, you're fine, I understand you, I get it. What is going on in your government?
Gina, you are an investor, you deal with a lot of businesses across the world. How does it feel to you?
The rest of the world is looking on at us, and it's gone from sort of bewilderment to now feeling sorry for us. When John says the rest of the world doesn't have, everything's rosy, it isn't. You've got renowned international institutions really worried. The market's really worried. We do not operate in isolation. Whatever we do domestically has a global effect. That's why the IMF have intervened and said what they said. That's why you've got institutions like TS Lombard, a hugely renowned, huge organisation, actually terming us as having a moron premium index, is what they said. You've got people like UBS.
What premium index?
A moron premium index. Because they're so worried about the financial peril of the way this government is running our country. We've got UBS, a huge organisation. I mean, around the world, they are worried about us. So you've got the financial worry. You've also got the fact that countries who emit confidence respect their institutions. Okay. And we've got governments, both governments, who've actually systematically gone about and actually damaged our institutions.
OK, James, here's these two pictures. This widely respected global power and this sad, pitiable little island. Where are you on this?
Well, I mean, the strange thing is there's truth in both, isn't there? I mean, everything Gina says about what's happened to our economy is obviously true, and yet we do still have this soft power. We have the English language, we have the BBC and the BBC World Service. We're enormously culturally influential. And I think sometimes for Britain, the problem is it's hard for us to get a perspective on which, you know, which one of those we are. Are we this amazing, culturally vibrant, globally influential cultural superpower? Or are we this sort of, you know, economic basket case that seems to, you know, have this sort of terrible growth problem, terrible productivity problem? And I suspect maybe a lot of our issues stem from failing to kind of match those two things up. And I think there's certainly maybe at times a kind of overestimation of Britain on the world stage that we make about ourselves, perhaps reading that soft power into hard power. And,
No, it's all right. I want to go back to the viewers' panel and I talked to one of our old friends, Chrisilda Basu. Chrisilda, tell me that when I talk to my relatives around the world, should I be feeling sort of jolly and proud, or should I be feeling miserable and slightly humiliated?
I feel that, yes, Britain is great. People risk their lives to get here because they know that they will be treated with respect and their human rights will be met and honoured. They have freedom of expression as well. When there is a problem in another country, Britain is always the first country they ask to help, both financially and morally. So, in my opinion, Britain is still great.
Thank you very much, Chrisilda. Let me go back to Paul Peachey. Paul, this is a point, isn't it, that we may feel a bit depressed about ourselves, we may look at all of the kinds of things that we've heard from, for example, Gina and James mentioned, but when push comes to shove, people do come to us. We've got a seat on the Security Council. The Ukrainians admire us. There's quite a lot to be said for us.
Well, yes. I mean, I would think that the UK was great at one point. We are still partly great, but we are diminishing our strength and our position in the world. What I can't quite get my head around is, after Brexit, how does an isolationist agenda make Britain great in the international community?
All right, Paul, thank you. A couple of people have mentioned the issue of Britain fighting for its values and people who put their lives on the line. I want to talk to Fred Beaumont, who served in the armed forces. I think, Fred, you've got a pretty trenchant view on this particular point. Fred, what's your thought?
Yeah, listen, of course Great Britain is great and relevant. Why? Because I live in this country and I know it's great. I love the place. And to all the people that live in this country, be proud of our country. We should be proud of it. We've been in worse predicaments than this in the past, and we didn't get on like this. Whinging, moaning, we got on with it. There was a can-do attitude, and we defeated what was in front of us. As a veteran, I served nearly 39 years. I saw people in other parts of the world looking up to our country and what good it's been doing and is still doing. Why do you think so many people from all over the world... do want to come to this country, and will do in the future, because it's a great place to live. You can put your people can put their thumbs down. It's a great place to live, and if you want to make it better, make it better. But it's a great place. I love the place.
Okay, Gina, there's a riposte. Why don't you all stop moaning?
It's not about moaning. It's about protecting what we have. Because it is a great place, and I would fight for this country. I love this country, but we can't keep on allowing our leaders to diminish it. It's not about the people who live here. And, you know, they said, we are the first to step up when there's a disaster, when we, you know, the amount of money we raise from the public, and in most instances, is quite astonishing, even when people are suffering. So, you know, we have great values. What we have to do is put in protections to make sure we don't lose what we value. And the tolerance that we have and the politics and the leaders we have are actually the ones who are destroying and poisoning it. And our machinery of government is just not strong enough. We've got to be able to protect the foundations of what makes us a good, happy, sound, tolerant, striving society. And it's those foundations that are not being looked after by our leaders.
All right, we're going to develop that point. You are watching The Great Debate. Up next, we're bringing back the B word. Time to talk about Brexit.
The choice is in your hands.
Folks, this is a once-in-a-lifetime, unrepeatable opportunity.
Sky News is projecting that the UK has voted out.
We're going to wave you goodbye.
Go